faithful and ever true. You're perfect in all your ways, and there is no one like you. Hey! Oh Lord, you are my God.
Oh Lord, you are my God.
Faithful and ever true.
Faithful.
We celebrate the Lord for each of you tonight. What an awesome God we serve. We're excited about Him and about how faithful the Lord is to each one of us. And we celebrate Him tonight from the depths of our hearts. We are so excited. Thank God for the fellowship choir and the powerful ministry and the anointing that's upon their lives. And we praise God for each of them tonight. I want to share with you tonight what the Lord has put on my heart. And we want to move through this with conviction and with a purpose. For certainly the Lord is speaking, and we want to hear from him the things that God is doing and is saying to us, and we give him the glory for how faithful he is to each one of us, and we honor him tonight for his goodness. We want to greet each of you tonight that have joined this circle. We encourage you to call someone and let them know tonight that there is a word from the Lord, and we don't want anyone to miss this. You ought to share this as often as you get a moment to do it, and just encourage the world. We're excited about who the Lord is and what the Lord is doing, and we want you to be excited about the Lord as well. Know that every time we come together, our conviction and our purpose is to win the lost for Christ, because we believe God to do tremendous exploits in the lives of every believer, and we want God to be glorified always in our lives. If we bow our heads briefly tonight for a word of prayer. God, we love you tonight, and we thank you for how good you are. We pray that, God, you will send your word tonight with power and with demonstration. We thank you, Lord, that yokes will be destroyed and lives would be transformed by the power and authority of the Holy Ghost. We celebrate you now because we believe that no weapon formed against us will ever prosper, and that, God, the word that you will speak to our hearts, we believe to be a word that will cause, Lord, transformation to take place. God, we don't want to leave this assembly tonight the way that we were when we came. God, thank you that you fulfilled in your word, God, the declaration in Psalm number 107 and verse 20, that you sent your word and healed. So, God, when healing comes, we know that transformation takes place. God, we thank you that your word has power, has wired in its DNA the ability to bring about the desired results that you purposed, oh God, in our lives. God, I pray that every individual that hears your word tonight would make a conscious decision of their own volition, make a decision that, God, I want you to do in and through me what God wants done in and through my life. God, thank you tonight that every heart has determined that I will partner with God to see God's purpose and God's design for my life unfold in my life. God, we speak it over this people now, and by faith declare it done. And we celebrate you for it in Jesus' name. And every believer say, thank God. Amen. Amen. We praise the name of the Lord. I want to, if I may, just call your attention to a very familiar passage of scripture. There are some things that the Lord has declared. I shared with you from this briefly some time ago. Matthew chapter 6 is where I want you to turn. Our purpose as we look at this, there are some things that I want to just lift before you, perhaps over the course of this weekend from this particular passage of scripture. Matthew chapter 6, I want to read. This is the Lord's Prayer. I want to read from verse number 5, and what we'll do is read down through in this this text, just a few of those verses. If you would just follow along with me for just a few moments. Now, we know that, again, what God is saying to us is giving us a model for how we are to engage the Lord in prayer. Follow this text, if you would. It says, and when you pray, it says, you shall not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you that they have their reward. Verse 6 says, but thou, when you pray, enter into your closet, and when you have shut the door, it says, pray to your Father, which is in secret, and your Father, which see in secret, shall reward you openly. But when you pray, verse 7, it says, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Verse 8, be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. After this manner, therefore, he says, I want you to pray. And he says, I want you to pray in this manner, is what the word says. And then he goes on to declare how he wants them to pray. And he says to them this, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." We thank God for the word of God. You may be seated. In the presence of God, what the Lord declares, I want to encourage you tonight from this theme that God is the source of our prayer. He is, in fact, the object of the prayer that we release from our hearts in behalf of whatever need we have. I want you to know that God is, in fact, the object of our prayer. He is, in fact, the personification of the prayers that we release. But there are several things that God says to us about prayer that I want you to simply allow your heart tonight to embrace. One of the things that the Lord said, I want you to know that, listen, from the start today, the focus of the lesson is to deal with the fact that God is the person, or he's the focus of prayer. He is the central figure in our praying and petitioning for anything that we have need of in the earth. I want you to know that, listen, that it's very interesting the fact that God has so much included, in the Lord's Prayer that covers, one, how we should approach God in prayer and what we should ask for, as well as how, listen to this, it should be petitioned. The Lord's Prayer, this prayer that we read starting in verse number 9, it goes down through verse number 13. The Lord's Prayer, it starts with this. After this manner, he says, "Therefore, you should pray." And then he says, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name," is what he says. Now, the start of the Lord's Prayer specifically addresses God and his name as hallowed, which means holy, or hallowed means sanctified, or hallowed or hallowed means set apart. The pronunciation of the word hallowed is literally hallowed, is what the pronunciation is. It's much like an interesting word that we use often, which means happy, is the word that we know as blessed. And many times when you pronounce the word blessed, you may use blessed. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And hallowed is a similar pronunciation. When you look at the Lord's Prayer, you immediately notice that the prayer is, interestingly, it is a plural prayer. It starts with the personal pronoun "our." It doesn't just simply say "my," but it says "our Father." This means the one that you are talking to in prayer, listen, is a person, and you should know that this person, listen, that calls upon, that this is a person that calls upon his name. Let me say it to you one more time. The person that we call upon is a person, and there are persons that are calling upon his name. We are people, and we call upon the person whose name is God the Father. That's who he represented. That's his title. I want you to listen, just follow with me as I give you point number one. This lesson I told you we'll move with a purpose tonight. I want you to know that God, according to the Lord's Prayer, that God is our Father. I want you to notice something about the Lord's Prayer. Point number one, God is our Father. And that maybe you not literally paid attention to in your studies. Listen, and that is the prayer of the Lord, or the model prayer, as I said, is a plural prayer. Now, so when you pray, God says in the prayer, "Our Father." So when you pray, listen, they then say, "Our Father." And he says, don't say "my Father." but he says our Father. He said you should, listen, include it as the plural. Now listen to all of these personal pronouns in this prayer. There are eight of them for those that may be counting. And he says, this is how I want you to pray. And I want you to know that it's not singular, which means it's not inward focused, but it is, listen, it is a global and outward focus. It says, our number one Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. And then he says, give us this day. And then he says, our daily bread. It's plural. And forgive us our debts as we, plural, forgive, plural, our debtors. And then he says, lead, plural, us not into temptation, but deliver, plural, us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Eight occurrences of the plural pronouns in the Lord's Prayer. And we know this because God wants us to know that we are a family. God wants us to know that, listen, we are not in the earth living in a vacuum, but we are part of a family. And even when you consider that fact, listen, this has to be, somewhat interesting to most of us. Some theologians said that the reason why the prayer is plural is because God is answering a plural question. And the question is, Lord, teach us to pray. And so he says, in answer to the question, listen, when you pray, pray our Father. I would simply conclude that this is, listen, perhaps a dubious, questionable point, because God did not say that prayer, listen, should be, listen, personal as he declared. He never said that. He lets us know that prayer is never removed from the personal perspective, but God wants us to know that not only, listen, should we cover ourselves, but that as a family we should cover others as well. And that's what Matthew, when we started this, started in verse 5. Look at what he says in verse number 6. It says, but thou, this is the personal element, when you pray, huh? He says, enter you in your closet. And then when you, he says, have shut the door in verse 6, it says, pray to your Father, which is in secret, and your Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward you personally in the open. But when you personally pray, it says, don't use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they drink, they think they should be heard for their much speaking. Now this verse is clearly, it shows that the personal aspect, listen, of our relationship with God is still allowed and required by God in the Word, that the Lord's Prayer, listen, did not change that, in any way. That means that we have personal relationship with God. And what God is saying to us is, while we have the opportunity, listen, to engage personally in God, salvation is not group. Salvation is not corporate. Salvation is personal. So he's telling them in the person, listen, you pray. You go into your closet. You shut the door and you talk to your God. Because, listen, how we get involved in the family is through personal choice. And where we go into the secret closet is perhaps when we ask God to come into our hearts. Listen, that's what indoctrinates us into the family. You're not born in the family of God. You're born rejected, huh? But then you are, listen, born again, accepted, is what the Word tells us. This can really, listen, again, the plurality reminds us. I want you to hear this, that we are a part of a family. We're part of the family of God, and we're born, listen, into a family as we come into the earth. But then we're born again into, listen, another family as well. But what you're not just to focus when you're calling on the name of the Lord, listen, in your prayer, listen, about yourself, but he said that you are required to pray for the needs of others as well. Look at what Ephesians, 3:14 and verse 15 says. You got to know that I'm a part of a family of believers. It's not just a local church. The local church is a family within a family. The local church is just a subset of the family of God, huh? And we are those that comprise that family. We are saying, God declaring us that, listen, we're not walking by ourselves. We are those that are part of the family of God. So God says, I want you to be reminded that, listen, I want you to call on me. Listen, whenever there's need in your life. Look at what Ephesians 3:14 says. It says, for this reason, grasping the greatness of this plan by which Jews and Gentiles are joined together in Christ. Let me say that one more time. It says, for this reason, I'm trying to amass or to understand, listen, the greatness of this plan that God has unfolding on the earth, listen, by which Jews and Gentiles are joined together as a family of God. Somebody ought to shout, I'm part of a family. He says, I bow my knees in reverence to God before the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. God the first and ultimate Father is what Ephesians 3:14 verse 15 says. We give reference to the family of God. It's not just, as I said, a reference to the local church, but rather a reference to the kingdom of Almighty God. The local church is, listen, a mere subset of God's, listen, global church. Yes, we're part of the body of Christ, but also we're part of the family of God as well. The truth is, listen, that we should also bring to life. This verse of scripture also, if you look down to Matthew 18, verse 19 and verse 20, where the Bible says, again, I say unto you, look at what the numbers say, talking about the unity in the spirit. He says in verse, 19 and 20 in Matthew 18, that if two believers on earth agree, that is, listen, if they are of one mind in harmony about anything that they ask within the will of God, he says it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. He says, for where two or three are gathered in my name, he says, meeting together as my followers, he says, I am there among them. Now, this says that, listen, we may come, listen, and assemble individually, but God says where there are multiples there, they represent the family of God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? This is what God is telling us, that the reason why, listen, the model prayer has plurality is because God is saying that you're not by yourself. You are a part of a family. And what he says in Matthew 18, and with it, when multiple folk gather or assemble together, God says, I want you to know that I am there in the midst of you. The phrase, the Bible says, in heaven, reminds us that God, listen, is sovereign. When it says, listen, our Father who art in heaven, that reference to heaven in the prayer, it suggests that God is sovereign and that he rules, listen to this, over all things. Y'all know the word. Listen, and that God is above all things. It says, our Father who art in heaven. Huh? It says, listen, he is above all things that happens on the earth. And so that means you can rest assured that because he's over all things, listen to what it says. God is above all the earth, and he is therefore the Lord of the earth. This suggests that God is, listen, is over all. And it suggests that God sees all. And it also suggests that God knows all. and that his power is over all. So therefore, listen, you can simply relax and know that, listen to this, that he loves me and he will perfect what concerns me. I love that verse. Listen, it says, if you know that God knows all, if you know that God sees all, and if you know that God is over all, if you know that God has power over all, listen, you can simply relax in knowing that whatever concerns you may have in your life, if your concerns are right now the coronavirus and is, listen, pillaging the earth, you can rest assured, because I know him and because the Lord knows me, because God knows, listen, who you are and where you are, because God knows exactly what you're going through, and he knows the condition and the content of your heart. You can relax and not be, listen, worried and all beside yourself, because you serve God that's over everything. So you don't have to fret. You don't have to worry about what God is able to do in the midst of the situation that we face. Because we serve a God that loves us, and a God that has all power and authority. That's what the word says. And remember this, this is not just a prayer, but it is the model that God has given to us to pray and to call on his name. Why? Because God don't want us nervous. I love what the word said in 2 Timothy 1 and verse number 7. For the Lord says, God has not, listen to this, a spirit, given us a spirit of fear. But what he says, that you may not know unless, listen, you place the alliteration where it perhaps make more sense to us. Let me say that verse this way. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but the verse says, but love and power. And what he's saying to us is this. He's saying God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but God gave us a spirit of power. Glory to God, a spirit of love, and that God gave us a spirit, my God, of a sound mind. That means, and listen, I'm not going to lose my mind because I have a spirit of soundness in my life. That means I'm going to stand on the word of Almighty God. That's why the word of God declared, God said that he will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. I came by here. Isn't it powerful that God left, listen, on record as the model for how we come before him, the model to remind us that, listen, I'm large and I'm in charge. And he said, you don't have to fret. You don't have to worry about anything. But all you got to do is just simply know that I am your father. And then to know that I know all, I see all, I have power over all. That's the God that we serve. You ought to celebrate, because the word said in Psalm number 138 and verse number 8, the Bible says, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Stuff. When the Bible says that God will bring to perfection everything that's a concern on your heart, you can know that God knows what's on your heart, and God is over all, and God has power, my God, over everything. And the Lord said, I know where you are. I know what you're concerned about. And God said, I'm working on your situation. So you may as well relax and know that if I'm for you, he says, I'm more than all the world that will ever be against you. I come to tell you this, that whatever you're facing right now, you got to know that because of what the word of God says, it means that God is able, oh God, to complete what he started in your life. I want to let you know that what happens to us often is we start listening to stuff that God did not say. Listen, in Psalm 138, my God, let me read verse 7 and 8. The Bible says in the Message Bible, I wanted to give you some other perspective. It says, when I walk into the thick of trouble, listen, the Message Bible says, keep me alive in the angry turmoil. It said, don't let my faith die. So God said, I got you when the tumult, listen, is raging around you. The Bible said God is holding you up with the right hand of his righteousness. I heard him declare in Isaiah 41 and verse 10, he said, fear not because I'm with you. He said, be not dismayed. Listen, he said, because I am your God. He said, I'll strengthen. He says, I'll help you. He says, I'll uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. God is here to tell you tonight. He said you don't have to die in the midst of the tumult because God said my hand is upholding you and you will not fall nor will you falter. You can rest assured that God, listen, has got you on this. So you may as well celebrate God and magnify his name even right now. Look at what the word says. He goes on to say, Lord, with one hand, you can strike my foes. With the other hand, you can save me. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. It's the very same verse where the Bible says he'll perfect what concerns you. Look at what God is declaring. He said, Lord, because you can strike my enemies with one hand and hold me in the other hand. And then he closes out by saying, finish what you started in me. Oh, God. It says, your love is always eternal. And he says, don't quit on me now. Oh, glory to God. I'm here to tell you that God, listen, cannot quit. That God shall not stop. You better know that because he's God. Listen, he's got you in the midst of the circumstances that you face. You may as well go ahead and celebrate God because there's nothing that's above him. There's nothing, my God, that's equal to him. So give God glory even right now. Let me tell you real quick. The prayer goes on to say, hallowed be thy name. Oh, yes, Lord. You got to know the word hallowed only appears in the New Testament just two times. It appears in Matthew 6, the verse we read for the text, and it appears again in Luke chapter 11. Listen, which are obviously the places where the Lord's Prayer appears. What the Bible says to us, the Greek word for hallowed appears in the New Testament about 30 times. 26 times the word is translated sanctified. The best way to understand hallowed, listen, as sanctified, is to say sanctify thou great name. That means to set your name. Your name is set apart from all other names. Somebody said in their testimony, there's nobody like God. Somebody said there's no name that's like the name of Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. How many of you all know there's no name like his name? Oh, yes, Lord. Listen, all through the Old Testament and the New Testament, my God, Hebrew in the old and Greek in the new. The word is translated very similarly. My God, in the Hebrew, and most of the time, is translated sanctified. When we get this word, it's always used in relationship to showing us that God's name is the opposite of profane. Did you hear what I said? It simply says that God's name is always the opposite of anything that's profane. Oh, glory to God. This means that God is set apart from evil in your life. That means that whenever you're going through craziness, you can rest assured it's not in his name. Oh, yes, Lord. That means that nothing crazy that you're going through, don't let the devil convince you that God must be up to this. But you got to let the devil know he's nothing but a liar. And the truth is not
in him. He is, however, I want you to know that means that God is so critical for us to understand that God's name is set apart from the profane. Listen, the reason why we got to understand this, you must know that he's not separated from us because God sent his son to bridge that gap. He's not separated from us, but what God is separated from, my God, is anything that causes evil to come into your life. You better know God has no place with that. Oh, yes, Lord. He's separated and set apart from the evil in your life. You got to let God know that, listen, you have to know that God in the Old Testament, he's not the cause of evil. Listen, that is in your life because God is set apart from the profane that's in your life. You got to know that God is not the author of any craziness or confusion. So don't let the enemy, my God, bring deception in your mind. I know the reason why some folk don't like to pray, because they have a problem resigning to the fact that why should I pray to somebody that's caused me all these troubles, someone that's allowed all this craziness to come in my life. My God wants us to know that I'm not the bad father, but I am the good father. Oh yes, Lord. Let me go on through this. The Bible says, Leviticus 22 in verse 32, it says, neither shall you profane my holy name, but I will be hallowed among the children of Israel. And you better know that, listen, the word hallowed, it means the same in this text that it means in, my God, the Lord's model prayer. But he goes on to say, I am the Lord which hallow you. Oh, glory to God. He says, not only am I set apart, but God said, I'm the one that set you apart as well. That ought to be enough for you to give God praise right where you are, that God said, I'm the one that brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. And then he closes with a postscript and says, I am your God. I wonder tonight, have you made the choice to accept him as your Lord? I wonder tonight if you made the choice to accept him as your God. Please note real quick that in this verse, that hallowed and sanctified are the same Hebrew words. Please leave, my God, this moment, my God, we have together tonight, knowing that God is set apart from the bad stuff that's going on in your life. Every negative thing that's happening in your life, you better know that God has, oh glory to God, no part in it. If your health is crazy, oh, that's not God. If your money is funny, that's not God. If your relationship is turned upside down, I come by to tell you, that's not God. Listen, if your job is acting foolish, I come to tell you that that is not God. God's name mean I'm separated and set apart from the profane. I'm separated and set apart from the evil that's happening in your life. You got to know that God wants us, my God, to have a conviction and to be free in our spirit to come to him whenever there's a need in our life. That's why he said, when you pray, you better know that he's not somebody else's father. You better know he is our Father. Oh yes, Lord. That's what God wants for us to know. Listen, this is because the one problem that praying our Father can cause is the fact that so many people don't have a good image of their earthly fathers. So praying our Father may cause some trepidation, my God, and some hesitation. Y'all know the word. It means some heartburn in our lives. We don't want to pray because because our fathers may have not, oh God, fulfilled our expectation. But I come to tell you that the God of the Bible, there's nothing in him that we need be mad or upset about, because there's nobody like him. Jesus tells us about two fathers in the word of Almighty God. And when we accept Christ, listen, I want you to know the good father becomes our father. When we accept Christ as our Lord, the good father becomes our father. But I don't want to exit tonight without letting you know that there are two fathers that the word of God speaks about. Some of us, when we think about the Trinity, my God, we've already labeled which one of them is this and which one of them is that. Y'all know that we think about God, he's the mean one. Oh, glory to God. And we think about Jesus, he's the good one. He's the one that walked among us. He's the one that died for us. He's the one that got up on resurrection morn and said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Y'all know how you think about God. Our Father, sometime you think about the fact that he wanted to kill us, but had it not been for his son who came to save us. Oh, glory to God. That's why it's hard for us when we need to call on him. It's a trouble for us, my God, to bow our knees and call on the name of the Lord, because we think that God is mad at us. I come to set you free tonight, because God wants to meet you in a place of prayer. God wants to meet you, my God, on your knees. Somebody said, I must tell Jesus all my struggles. I can't bear these burdens alone. I want if you call on him, I come to tell you tonight, if you call on him, he will answer. Oh yes, Lord, I want to let you know that God is our father. But then Satan, he's the bad father. That's point number two. Let me read it to you in John chapter 8. I got to hurry on here. It says, I speak that which I have seen with my father, is what Jesus was telling them. He said, and you do that which you have seen of your father. He's talking about the bad father. He said, they answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. And Jesus said, this is in John 8:38-44. He said, then they answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Then Jesus said unto them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I've heard of God. This did not Abraham. It said, you do the deeds of your father. He's talking to unrepentant. My God, heathens right now. He says, you do the deeds of your father. It says, then they said to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father. They said, even God. And Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, now these were those reprobates, these were those heathens. They said, God is our father, but here they talking to the Son of Almighty God. And Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. It says, you are of your father. And he defined who he is and said, your father is the devil himself and the lust of your father. He said, you gonna do. He says, he was a murderer from the beginning and he abode not in the truth because there ain't no truth in. Listen, the bad father, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. When he speaketh a lie, listen, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar. And the father of all lies is what the word of God said. Listen, you don't want to engage conversation with the devil himself, because the Bible said he only came to steal, kill, and to destroy. And he says, I'm come that you might, but Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And he closed it with this. And Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd, and the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. When you hear thoughts, I want you to know that, listen, every time the devil's lips are moving, you know he's nothing but a liar. I know somebody asked, how can I see his lips moving? Let me tell you how they move. They'll come into your thoughts and tell you stuff, my God, that doesn't align with the word of God. They'll tell you that God has not forgiven you. They'll tell you the sickness that you have, my God, put it on you. Listen, because you haven't walked every step the way God wanted you to. Oh, glory to God. You better just start to declare, the devil is a liar, and I'm not going to pay attention to the lies that he tells. I come to tell you, listen, you know he's lying when those thoughts that don't align with the word of God are permeating your thoughts. My God, I know you thought you were coming out last week, but because it did not happen, the enemy said, well, all you've been doing to trust God, and God backed up on you and did not deliver what you desired him to deliver in your life. I come to tell you, the devil is a liar. And the truth is not in him. Oh, glory to God. This is what the word of God says. You got to know that there's a word in theology called propitiation. And then salvation is nothing more than a word that said, listen, all the wrath that God had against you, it was satisfied on the cross by the blood of Jesus Christ. Listen, and the propitiation or the substitution for our sin, God's wrath has already been appeased. So you can relax right now and know that if you're in Christ, you better know the Bible says you're hidden with Christ in God. You can tell the devil he may as well stop trying to implant those thoughts in your mind, because you know greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. I come to tell you that God loves you, and by the blood of Jesus Christ, he has already forgiven you. Oh, glory to God. And Satan is, he's always lying and trying to get you to believe his lies. I know that's why the word says, it says casting down, listen, every imagination and every thought that exalted itself against the knowledge of Christ. He says, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You got to grab attention, my God, and wrestle those lies and the thoughts the enemy tries to put in your mind, and let yourself know that I am who God says that I am. You better know that God has called you blessed, that God has called you more than an overcomer. God has called you the head only and not the tail. Yes, he has. You got to start calling yourself what God has already called you. Let God be glorified in your life. Have you ever had, listen to what this saying, don't you think it's possible, listen, for us to get mad at God because we believe the lie that the devil told us about God? Let me ask you one more time, don't you believe it's possible for us to get mad at God because of a lie the devil told us about our God? Have you ever had a friend to rake you over the coals due to a lie that somebody told them about something you allegedly did against that friend? Let me say it one more time. You know it's possible for us to get mad at God because of a lie the devil told us about God, because some of us have had the experience of having a friend to call us up and rake us over the coals because of a lie that somebody told them about something you allegedly did or even said. You know a lot of people do this on their knees, and they call it prayer. But I come to tell you that what God wants from us is to be on our knees, crying out to God and giving God the glory because he's nothing but good. The Bible says in Psalm number 119 and verse number 68 that the Lord is good and he does good. Oh yes, Lord. You ought to put your hands together and celebrate God because God is our Father and Satan is the bad father. Listen, you better know that God is the good Father. In James 1, 13 through 15, I'm closing when I tell you, let no man say when he goes through trouble that the trouble comes from God. It says, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth God any man. Oh yes, Lord. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. It says, then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, it bringeth forth death. This is James chapter 1, verse 13 through 15. And I'm going to read you now verse 16 and 17. The Bible said, listen, brother, don't get it twisted. It said, don't err, my beloved brethren, because he said every good gift, glory to God, and every perfect gift, it comes from above. Listen, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness. And the Bible says, neither shadow of turning. He said, brothers, don't get it twisted. Let me encourage sisters, twist it. Listen, every good gift, listen, and every perfect gift, it comes from glory to God, and it cometh down from the Father.